it is Sunday, and the very first reading and the very last reading from, I remember from singing the Messiah so many times. There's that wonderful, rejoice, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king comes to you. And then those verses, come unto me, all ye who labor, are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And I thought it was a very interesting coincidence that our scriptures were sort of bookended by those two wonderful verses that we hear sung every year at Christmas time. And that is the hopefulness of everything that we have and everything that we are. Zechariah is one of the later prophets, as Jim mentioned, and his writing is oftentimes understood as a summing up of the whole prophetic tradition, Isaiah and Hosea and Joel and Amos. And he carries that prophecy forward into the future as one of the latest prophets. There's a lot of symbolism in scripture and a lot of it in the prophets. They were very symbolic creatures, people, and they brought forward images of everyday life that people could relate to in their prophecies. Zechariah talks about the messianic king, the king that the Jews hoped for in the future, who was going to be the one who defeated all of their enemies, created victory from themselves, and brought peace and prosperity to them. The image that he presents is a familiar one, because not only do we listen to it sung in the Messiah, but it comes forward in the Gospels as well. And that's the idea of a king who comes into the city gates on a donkey. And there's a lot of potency in this image because it says a lot about the nature of this king. Now, donkeys were pretty ubiquitous in the lives of people in the Old Testament. A donkey is, as we often call it, a beast of burden. I don't know if any of you have ever done a donkey ride, like down into the Grand Canyon or anywhere gone on a donkey ride. I haven't myself, but I've talked to people who have. And they truly are a very steadfast animal. And you can load them down, and you can send them up the trail, and off they go. And oftentimes, they are ridden on trails as well. And of course, we read very famously of Joseph acquiring a donkey for Mary to ride that long trip from Bethlehem to Jerusalem. And not once did we hear of the donkey kicking anyone or kicking anyone off, okay? They're often misunderstood. Incredible beasts of burden, and they were part of the everyday life of people. Farmers, of course, use donkeys. Small business owners use donkeys because they were the carriers of goods, okay? So donkeys were everywhere, and donkeys were trusted. Donkeys could be relied on. And they were, again, this image, the beast of burden. So the messianic king is not someone who comes through the city gates on a horse, leading his troops through the town, proclaiming victory. No. The messianic king lives and works among the people and carries their burdens for them. Now, horses don't figure very prominently in the stories of the Old or New Testament because they were not integrated into the life of people. Horses were beasts of battle. They were the steed that soldiers rode. And so when there's a sense of an animal that someone rides for a great purpose, it is not a glorious stallion. It is a donkey. So that should be your first clue. If you're wondering, rides on a donkey? And who doesn't lead battalions? And who doesn't come in with victory? Who doesn't come in with ticker tape parades? He shows up on a donkey. And then those who feel led to offer him a parade will create it from his presence among them. So here we have a donkey riding, possibly carpenter, is trained by his father, who spent some time in temple studying laws and revealing through his life the will of God. And he comes into town on foot or on donkey, and what he really does is he sits down with people. And he eats dinner with them. And he sits on the ground with them. They probably have like something like picnics, because he always managed to bring enough food for everybody. And he teaches. And he talks. And maybe answers questions. And if someone is hurting, he heals. And this is the Messianic King, the image of the ruler of the people for the gospel writers. This particular teaching, and the reason it sounds a little disjointed is that the scripture does not include all the verses, so we're going to skip over. But he's talking to the people, and he's saying, you know, people can be very, very fickle. And here is an illustration. Kids playing in the marketplace. And a lot of times when children play among themselves, when they don't have video games and TV shows and stuff like that, they create their own games and they create their own dramas. And they base them upon the adult lives. Some of us remember these that we used to do, just our make-believe games that were kind of based on the lives that we observed, the lives that the grown-ups around us lived. Because that's how we learned to be adults, was playing the games that imitated what our parents did. And so they say, well, you're not playing by the rules, because when we play festival, you won't play festival with us. And when we play funeral, you won't play funeral with us. What's your problem? Don't you know how to play our games? This is what Jesus is expressing. I come to you showing you the way, and you don't follow. John came. He's my cousin. He's my predecessor. He's my great announcer. And he came as someone who fasts, someone who lives a very austere life. And you looked at him in judgment and you said, what is he, demonic? What's his problem? He won't eat. And so here I come. I'm happy to eat. I always bring enough food. And if there isn't enough, I'll make more. And you accuse me of being a glutton and a drunkard. I went to a wedding once in Cana and there wasn't enough wine, so I made more. What's the problem here? Judgment. The inability to see what's right in front of you with clear eyes and be able to say, oh, he's among us. And Jesus, in the midst of this, sort of turns away from talking to people and starts talking to God. I am so happy and relieved that you chose me to give this word to these people. Not the great Caesars, not the great rulers, but these are your people. These are my people, the ones among whom I walk as a beast of burden. And then when he returns, unjust government. You live like oxen on a yoke. But if you come with me, if you follow me, if you live according to my life, then you realize that my yoke is not the yoke of burdens, but the yoke of joyous work for one another. Okay? As one preacher once said, he didn't say to the people, come on to me, because my chairs are easy. And my bundles are pretty light, good gifts for all. He said, no, it is a yoke. It is something that you have to wear that joins you to each other so that you can move forward, so that you can do the work of God. Connected to each other. Because when we connect to each other in the Holy Spirit, we are not here to burden each other, but to lift each other up. Whether it's through prayer, whether it's through friendship, whether it's through singing together, whether it's through healing, whatever enters your heart that is your purpose and your passion. That is your yoke, not a burden, but a gift and a work. Consider a yoke something like this. If you've ever watched oxen working with the yoke, it is a large piece. It can be iron, it can be set metal, and it connects them to each other and to what they're pulling behind them. And they're pretty steady animals, kind of like donkeys, just do what they're supposed to do until they're done, and then the yoke is removed. When I think of a yoke with regard to human life and regard to our work for the kingdom, I see that my arm goes over the shoulder of the person on my right and the person on my left, and their arms go around my shoulders like a yoke. And when we stand this way, we stand together. And if we were acrobats, we could hold people on our shoulders this way. That is our yoke. Our yoke is our community. It's our faith, and it's the call that we have, not just as individuals, friends or families, but as a world community of faith, to stand arm in arm, over shoulder, to create something that is hard to break, and something that lifts everybody up, and something that continues to give us hope. Now, Zechariah had prophesied that the Messianic king was there for the prisoners of hope. Interesting idea. Prisoners of hope. That feels like an oxymoron to me. It kind of feels like two opposites in one phrase. And then you kind of have to go, what does this mean? How can you be a prisoner of hope? I think what the prophet is projecting is that as long as we have hope in where we are, we have no place else to go. Our hope is what keeps us here in this place, in this sure that you've had that feeling that, oh, I wish I could be there. I wish I could be there. I wish I could go and hug these children. I wish I could go with food and feed these people. I wish I could go and heal the wounds of people whose lives have been torn apart by war and conflict. But I'm here. Well, guess what? There's plenty of stuff going down right here that we need to open our eyes to and say, this is the place where I'm called. This is the people to whom I'm called. And what can we be doing with and for and alongside each other? St. Francis says, we are not there to be for the poor, because that is another form of control. We are called to be with, which means to be alongside each other, arm in arm, yoked with each other. And then when we begin to share the burdens of our hearts with each other, then we know that this yoke can be easy because of love. And this burden that we bear for each other is light, because it's for people we love. Jesus says, come unto me. Everything I have to give to you is for your hopefulness, for your life together, and for your part in lifting up your little corner of the world.